before the pyramids, before the Valley of the Kings, there was the Mastaba. The word Mastaba is Arabic in origin, where it means stone bench, and the resemblance to a stool or bench is clear from the squat shape. They aren't generally made of stone, however, but rather adobe bricks. A mastaba might rise 6 to 10 metres high, they varied in size, but a typical floor plan might be roughly 15 by 50 metres. They each comprised between 1.3 and 2 million bricks, as well as some stone or wood, mostly for the sake of structural stability and in some cases grandeur. Including time for the huge number of bricks to thoroughly dry, a mastaba might take 13 to 14 months of work for somewhere between 400 and 600 bricklayers and other artisans and labourers to complete, and a further 2 months for the post-interment construction, sealing the tomb after the deceased has been placed within the burial chamber. The ancient Egyptian term for these monuments is parjadaw, which is often translated to House of Eternity. The eternity in question is conceived of as an eternity where all is enduring and remains the same, hence another common translation, House of Stability. If you were feeling more poetic than literal, and I often am, you might try something like House Imperishable. I made that one up, so don't quote it. Mastabas are often referred to as tombs, but human remains were not generally stored within the structure itself, but rather below in a dedicated sealed chamber. The mastaba had several important functions. It allowed mourners and supplicants to the deceased to place tribute at a dedicated altar, and the earliest mastabas were functional houses designed to be inhabited by the living spirit of the deceased. They featured rooms that mimicked the rooms of larger houses and palaces, fitting since in the earliest days mastabas were reserved for royalty and others of very particular importance. These rooms, while not intended to be visited by the living, were nonetheless decorated with friezes depicting the day-to-day life of the deceased, as well as certain decorative and functional items that might come in handy in the afterlife. Mastabas were almost always aligned north-south, with west-facing false doors to allow the inhabitant's soul to come and go as they pleased. The burial chamber was to the south, that is, the part of the tomb closest to the path of the sun, which was the conveyance the royal souls used to travel to and from the afterlife. As well as the body, which was intended for inhabitation by the returned soul, many mastabas also contained a statue of the deceased, kept in a hidden part of the tomb, both to remind the soul what form to take and to serve as a backup body in case of the destruction or decomposition of the original. The mastabas were designed not just with commemoration in mind, but also security. They were intended to allow access to the soul of the inhabitant and to mourners and priests, but not to thieves or wild animals. The burial chamber, built below the earth at the end of a narrow, sloping shaft, discouraged, but didn't outright prevent, grave robbing, and allowed for burial with a bit of ceremony. However, a burial chamber and sarcophagus don't allow natural mummification to occur. In the desert, the hot, dry sand could wick away moisture and allow for the natural preservation of the body, though of course it was very likely that desert fauna would make off with the corpse before this happened, if, for example, a high wind should shift sand away from the burial. To compensate for this, the practice of artificial mummification was developed, which of course became the Egyptians' signature move. A mastaba necessarily had to be constructed in various phases, so the large number of labourers were well organised to optimise their productivity. The less skilled labour in the beginning, the gathering and hauling of the tons of mud and straw needed to make bricks, would be sourced through a system known as corvée, where someone pays their dues to the state with direct labour. Imagine, instead of giving a proportion of your income to tax, you had to do an equivalent amount of unpaid work on top of your main job. That's corvée. As more skilled work was needed, masonry, carpentry, and geometry, those workers would be paid in rations. With the skilled labour and less common materials that would need to be sourced either through dedicated expeditions far afield or through expensive imports, a mastaba wasn't a cheap affair. There's a discrepancy you might have noticed between the availability of workers, most likely the season of inundation when the fields were underwater, and the availability of high clay mud, that is, any season other than inundation. The variable availability of supplies, including those exotic woods that needed to be imported, meant that really the construction might take place over more the space of a couple of years, rather than just the 13 to 14 months of absolute time required. Beneath all these cold facts and figures, the number of workers, the amount of mud and straw, there's an impressive truth. The Mastabas took incredible levels of organizing. They had to source 3 cubic kilometers of clay and enough straw to make that clay into sturdy bricks, and enough men to press those bricks and enough space to store the bricks for drying, and inspectors to make sure that every brick will hold together before it's hauled off to the construction site. It's not a casual affair. Pharaoh can snap his fingers and order construction of a mastaba, but don't let the humble outward appearance of these monuments fool you into thinking they're just piles of bricks. Of course, we all know that the kings of Egypt would move on to pyramids during the Old Kingdom, and later, grand, complex tombs cut into the Valley of the Kings with even grander mortuary temples in separate locations. Even so, mastabas would continue to be used by non-royals for around 1,000 years after the Pyramid Age. They grew less complex as time went on, eventually ceasing to have a palatial internal structure and becoming little more than cairns with an altar near the entrance for the necessary rites to be performed. If you look at this photo of a mastaba and think, gosh, that sloped wall looks a bit familiar, and what even is a stepped pyramid anyway, then you're onto something. In my next iconic architecture video, we'll look at the earliest pyramids and how they defined a new epoch of tomb design. In the meantime, sound off in the comments if you can think of any other iconic structures you want me to talk about, or if you have any questions or corrections about mastabas. Until next time, life, prosperity, and health to you all. Thanks for watching. Head over to my channel for more, or click here to see what the YouTube demons think you should watch next. I hope you'll consider subscribing. If you'd like to support and collaborate on the channel with me, go to patreon.com/armchairegypt. You can also join my Discord community. There's an invite link in the description.